The Magic Show is brought to you by StarCityGames.com, and check this out. I have this really cool Magic Show playmat that just got released, and I don't know if you guys have seen it yet, but it is awesome, and me and Pete Heffling from StarCityGames.com have been working on this for a while to give you the ability to support the show and have something cool to show for it. This type of support allows me to buy equipment and go to different shows and places and bring you more cool stuff that you enjoy week in and week out. So I've been doing this for a couple years, get plenty of people asking me, you know, how can I help you? How can I support the show? Well, this is it, ladies and gentlemen. Check out StarCityGames.com and pick up your Magic Show playmat today.
This is Charles Gendy, U.S. National Champion. Welcome to the Magic Show.
Godzilla right now. You don't even understand. Like, everybody's just going to like, everybody's going to be like playing like their putrid leeches and stuff, and I'm just going to like, it's like everybody else's buildings and I'm Mechagodzilla. I'm stepping on them like with my robotic dinosaur-ness, and it's just not even close. Like, I'm going to win this Nationals, like, guaranteed. 3,000%. Done.
Climbing up a fire escape.
Hi everybody, it's currently Friday morning on 7:45, and last night after 10 hours of driving I got in and I ran to the last LCQ and the absolute last standard LCQ I got into, and so I picked up Shuhei's list, which is right here, where he's playing the Wrath of God, or the Cruel Ultimatum control, basically, and I mean like classic Cruel Ultimatum control. Almost no new cards other than Essence Scatter for what would be Remove Soul. I was a big fan of it, and I want to play it again today. And I'm super excited because I've never actually played in Nationals. I've covered it once or twice, and it's fantastic. And I'm about ready to go downstairs and register, and we'll see how the rest of the day goes.
Still don't feel like it was entirely necessary. I think it's fine. I mean, I certainly don't think. I mean, the Magic clearly hasn't died. I mean, here we are at the highest attended Nationals, U.S. Nationals in history.
I just realized that some of the cards are a lot worse. Thopter Foundry, Scarlet Thranix. I second picked a Thopter Foundry in the first draft. That was really bad. Just didn't do anything.
They make reads so important, and everybody's saying they like dumb the game down, but they don't dumb the game down. And like, people like reference Aaron Forsythe's article where he's like, you know, like some technical play content has been lost, which isn't true. Like, if like it's so heavily like helps the players who like have the ability to read people extremely well. And I love the new changes.
It did not come up for me much this weekend. There was one point in Limited where I had Dauntless Escort, and I made a weird attack, and then I realized that it was weird because you can't put damage on the stack anymore, and that didn't end too well for me. So then it came home to me that changes were here.
It seemed like they just changed the game entirely, but now that I played with it, it changes a couple things, but not like a big deal. You know, like I can't, you know, bounce my Blood Raid Elf with Cryptic Command with damage on the stack or whatever, but you know, I'm over it.
You know, they didn't have to go there. They did, like, if you do it the way that Eric Taylor came up with, it saves all the problems that they wanted to deal with. It saves the newbie problem, and more importantly, it doesn't train the newbies into bad habits. And as Eric said, it took him all of 5 seconds to come up with it. creatures only deal combat damage if they're in the combat zone. So, we have this battlefield, right? And a part of the battlefield is the combat zone. If a creature is not in the combat zone, it does not deal combat damage. It's very simple. The Dead Mog Fanatic doesn't deal damage because it's in the graveyard. It accomplishes the task that they wanted. I have talked about this solution to numerous people. I have yet to hear anyone's complaints.
It started with some innocuous things, right? Like, oh, maybe when I mulligan, you can say if you're gonna mulligan, and then we can shuffle at the same time.
What?
Wow! That'll be great. So we start talking about things like that, and then, you know, we say, oh, this lifelink thing. People do this wrong every time. It's like, oh, it's a trigger, you're dead, I'm sorry. Judge, tell him he's dead. Like, that's kind of lame.
Yeah.
Maybe we should change that. So that's where all these discussions went. One fateful day, someone said, what about this damage on the stack thing that no one gets? It's like every time we go to a local store pre-release, it's kind of embarrassing when it's like, oh, well, damage on, call to heal my guy. Ha ha. So, it's like, when there's a rule that you're embarrassed to explain to your player, that's probably bad.
Uh-huh.
So, now it's not there anymore. Token ownership, really. Fun fact, Mark Gottlieb, Magic Rules Manager, Aaron Forsyth, Head of Magic R&D, are the human being who made Warp World and one of the human beings in the world who likes Warp World the very most. Those two men are responsible for that rules change.
Wow.
They feel your pain, and they still think it's better for the game.
I just played round one versus Chris Lockman, and probably couldn't have chose a worse matchup. He was playing red-black with just tons of burn, and his first four plays game one were Blightning, Anathomancer. So I lost. Game two, I was on three life for like 1,000 turns, basically, and I had to kill him using Mole Drifters and a Puppeteer Click after holding three Cryptic Commands in hand so I wouldn't die from basically any spell in his deck. Game four, he got me down to three in about 5 turns through Flame Javelins and Lightning Bolts. And finally, he Tar Fired me, and I could have countered the Tar Fire and went to and stayed, you know, at three. Or take the Tar Fire and go to one with a Broken Ambitions and Cryptic Command in hand, and he had 4 untapped lands. So I chose to take it, and of course he had the Fallout, and I never drew any Rune Halos or Cruel Ultimatums for what it's worth. But so playing my worst matchup round one is not the end of the world, not on tilt or anything, not worrying about it. I mean, I would much rather play something like Fairies all day rather than basically the hate deck for my... So I just played round two against the one and only Louis Scott Vargas, and he was playing Fairies. And I don't want to say I was ever really in it. I brought in 4 Sable Stags and Rune Halos, and so I never drew my Sable Stags, and the Rune Halos didn't do as much as I wanted to, and he thought seized away the Volcanic Fallout in my opener in game two anyway. So at the end of the day, I'm not too upset to lose to LSV. At this point, I'm kind of hoping that my round three does not include a Pro Tour champion across from me.
Overall, it's pretty good.
It's worth a lot of money. I'm not sure if it's really a great set.
I like what they did with the core set. I think they did a really good job.
I'm happy and disappointed. There's a lot of power creep.
Lightning Bolt is insane. Like, I don't even understand that card. Like, every time I draw it, I'm just... This card's really fair.
Design and flavor-wise, it's absolutely awesome. I love the change to making new cards and making generic flavor, like generic fantasy flavor cards. And sleep is the greatest thing ever. Classic D&D spell made into a magic card does exactly what it should do. Perfect.
I mean, the core set for a long time has basically been pointless. Mm-hmm. The core set has basically been a list of cards that are legal in Type 2. Mm-hmm. And now M10 is a bunch of cool new cards. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's a lot more fun to draft. No one ever drafted it before. You know, and part of the reason that you draft sets, part of the reasons that that people enjoy drafting sets is they like to open cards that they want. Mm. You know, it's cool to win a draft that has a Baneslayer Angel in it. You know, and it's cool to be able to get like dual lands out of the draft. But when you're opening packs and all these cards are incredibly low value because they're just basic cards that have been reprinted a million times, I mean, there's a lot of value lost there. People don't like cracking those packs.
Honestly, people just like want to complain about something, and that's why everybody was like, oh man, losing stack damage, I don't know if I can do that. But before 6th edition, you know, there was no damage on the stack, people didn't complain.
Right.
People just dealt with it. Then when they changed it, you know, everybody's like, oh, I'm quitting, I'm not going to deal with this, I don't want to have to learn these new rules. Sure enough, you know, they're back at the card store next week, playing just like everybody else, learning the new rules.
It's about average as far as a draft set. I think it's actually worse than 10th edition. I like 10th edition limited a lot, but that's kind of probably because I won a lot and people didn't really know what they were doing.
I live in a magical fantasy world when I play this deck. Like, I'm unbeatable. Like, this deck is like Excalibur. No. Okay, this deck is like, you know, like, you ever read Lord of the Rings? Not the movies, because, like, you know, like, when you read it, like, with the sword, how everybody just, like, cowers in fear. Like, nobody will even fight Aragorn when he's got that sword. They're just like, whoa. Like, forget about it. That's, you know, that's what it's like when I'm playing this deck. Like, it's just unbelievable. I'm playing against elves, right? It's game 3. I mulligan to 5 on the play, right? In play, I have a Woolly Thakdar, or 2 Woolly Thakdars, and a Figure of Destiny, and 4 lands. And he has, like, I think 7 creatures and like a bunch of lands. And he has like, I have like nothing in my hand, and he has like 4 cards in hand. I crushed him. Done. I won the game with 5 cards in my hand.
Was it close?
Alright, so we are currently 0-3, and God, it hurts bad. I played Kithkin, which should be a ridiculously good matchup for me, and it pretty much was. Game 1, I trounced him. Game 2, I drew no lands. I just sat around on like 6 or 7 mana, had no counters on my Vivids, had no Reflecting Pools, a bunch of Cruel Ultimatums and Broodmate Dragon to my hand, and he finally just overwhelmed me. Game 3, I did the dumbest thing ever, which was you never, ever, 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 ever keep the filter-only hand. And he mulled the 6 and basically killed me on turn 4 or 5.
Good.
I'm not upset that Rascon and the way they're promoting Planeswalkers makes Planar Cleansing coming in makes more sense to me.
When you take out Wrath of God, White gets to redefine itself as, like, I want to have a lot of creatures in play and they're going to work together, which is not a viable strategy with the format of Wrath of God in the format.
Wrath being gone is a way bigger deal than people are sort of making it out to be. I think that Wrath of God sort of existed in this place where even if it wasn't played, it had a huge impact on how people built decks, and also a huge impact on how games are played. And I mean, it's sort of weird because Wrath, when it rotated out, was in a really bad spot. It was in a format where, you know, the white decks, you know, the decks that could play Wrath of God, you know, had a bunch of other options that they would play, like Volcanic Fallout or Fire Spout. And the decks that, you know, you'd want Wrath of God against had a card like Dauntless Escort.
Well, the crazy thing to me about Wrath of God was that so many decks were just not playing it. You have this 5-color control decks that are saying, oh no, thank you, we don't need Wrath of God. It's like, certainly it's a staple card and it's really in people's mind spaces, but then when you get an Eric Lauer type of guy who's just super analytical, he's going to look at deck lists and kind of stare at you and say, are you really going to miss that?
I think it's like the quintessential like skill tester in Magic, you know? Like, the one thing you should know how to play against is Wrath of God, and like, it's just like, I just like how Wrath of God works in formats, and like how it's like just one of the most interesting cards.
Baneslayer Angel is ridiculous the moment it hits play.
I think it's really overrated, but I think it's good. Like, I was playing, you know, I play Kithkin obviously, and I've beaten it every time someone's cast it, so.
I almost played one Baneslayer Angel over a Johnny Vengeant, and I am very glad I did not, because Johnny Vengeant was amazing all day.
It's a little overpowered, but I don't mind some overpowered creatures. It's 5 mana, so it's not gonna, like, break anything wide open. But,
The power creep on Baneslayer Angel when specifically compared to Sarah Angel is a little sad on the one hand. On the other hand, White needed it.
A 5 mana creature that doesn't give you any value when it comes into play, doesn't generate implicit card advantage, needs to be ridiculous to be constructed playable right now.
It's insane. It's so good. It's protection from Broodmate Dragon. It's so good. The card is just beyond absurd. Like, it's a great card that dies to Shriekmaw and Doomblade and a couple lightning bolts I threw at it over the weekend. You know, it's great when you get to attack with it, but it does die to a lot of things.
Absolutely.
It's a good card. I mean, we talked about this before, Evan.
Absolutely. I'm getting you on camera this time.
Yeah, you're, I had to, like, you know, hold you back. You're enraged about Baneslayer. You're like, Lapilli, get over here. I got to talk to you in private. And I'm like, no, man, it's not worth it. It's not worth it, dude. Just settle down. Walk away.
I mean, it's just a creature. Like, Kibler loved it. I don't really get it. Sean McKeown loved it. Just like, I was playing Doomblade in my Fairies deck because people are playing like Baneslayers and Plume Veils and stuff, so it doesn't seem like that card is that good. I mean, very overrated.
I played Shivan Dragon on my sideboard in Hollywood. Like, showed like the difference in power level of cards. And to show how insane Fairies was during that tournament. In that tournament, Fairies had Ancestral Visions. Like, that was like so unfair. They had Ancestral Visions and they had Damnation postboard, and like, and I was playing Shivan Dragons in my sideboard. Like, and now like Fairies is like 10 times weaker, and like there are all these creatures that are like 1,000 times better than the ones I was playing, and Fairies is like still tier one. So kind of illustrates that, like, just having a deck like that warps the format so much.
I love Baneslayer Angel. Baneslayer Angel is, I think, you know, the most powerful creature that's currently in Standard. I mean, other than Bloodbraid Elf and stupid things like that. In terms of you know, the individual power level of the creature, I mean, Baneslayer Angel wins you games you have no right winning. I mean, I played Baneslayer Angel in my Standard deck and took 20-something damage from an Anathomancer in a game and wasn't even close to losing because I had Baneslayer Angel.
Wow.
I mean, there's no other creature that changes the game as much when it comes down. I mean, there's the debate over, you know, Baneslayer Angel or Broodmane Dragon. And, I mean, it'll seem like I'm the losing side of that debate because there's a bunch of Broodmane Dragons in the top 8, but I still think Baneslayer Angel is far better. You know, the situations where you Baneslayer costs less, you know, the situations where you play a Baneslayer and your opponent doesn't immediately remove it, you virtually always win.
For round 4, I actually won. I'm so excited. Played Fairies, and they were not LSV, so I won this time.
This is after the draft, and I drafted Blue White Aggro, sort of in honor of Olivier Ruel, because I've watched him draft this deck, this archetype, many, many times on StarCityGames.com through the Drafting with Ollie section. So I've got 3 Court Homunculuses, and I got a Path to Exile, which was nice. I also picked up this card, like 3rd, Haven Mimeomancer. Like, that card is pretty hot. I'm excited to kind of curb up and see if I can put some pressure on all these, like, awesome decks that don't get started until turn 5 or 6.
Hold on one more time with feeling. Try it again. Breathing's just a rhythm. Say it in your mind until you know that the words are right. This is why we fight.
How could they not think that printing this wouldn't be deeply format warping?
I mean, well, it's funny because they sort of printed it to, you know, to unwarp the format, you know, and now it's done the opposite.
Yeah, well, they printed Curse Scroll to unwarp Hypnotic Spectre. Okay? That's like, Curse Scroll was like, they're like, let's finally deal with him, the Torok Hypnotic Spectre. Good job.
It came a little late, and
well, so did Kataki for that matter. Remember, showed up in Saviors, and you're like, "Hello,
who are we saving? They're gone." You know how ridiculous blue black has to be in Zendikar for blue black to be a playable, like blue black control, like just straight up to be a playable constructor deck. It's going to be impossible. There's no chance of beating this deck. Like, even your word readings go away. Like, you're just dead.
Played a Naya deck that wasn't very good for what it's worth, and when I say it's not very good, people go, like, how do you know it's not very good? Well, if you're playing Shard Convergence to only get a Plains and a Mountain, that's bad. The deck's not very good. He went turn 2 Pro Artifact Guy, and turn 3 Vithian Renegades, turn 4 Vithian Renegades, which basically is my deck because everything's pretty much an artifact creature. So that's a little disappointing. I just couldn't overcome the fact that he always had the Renegades whenever I had anything close to resembling a decent start.
I'm back from the second round of my first draft, and I won. Oh my God, who can believe it? I actually won. My deck did exactly what I wanted to do at that point. I curved from Court Homunculus into Ethercast Knight, into Akrazan Squire. You know, and basically was like swinging for four with my little 2/2. The sort of went all the way. My Glass Dust Hulks, you know, both of them were just fantastic. And I'm excited about it once again because I was pretty happy with it. And it's time to win one more so we can at least finish this draft out. It's a 2-1.
So was last week's article an attempt to lull your draft opponents into a false sense of security?
Actually, that's a great question.
That was a hell of a 4-3-2-2. I ain't gonna lie.
That 4-3-2-2, sir, you know, I had some of the toughest competition I have ever seen in a 4-3-2-2. Grokslide Elemental, if I had a second chance, it would definitely be Infest. That's all I'm saying.
Hi, my name's Kelly Reid. I run QuietSpeculation.com, your source for gaming financial news. Great Sable Stag was another card that people couldn't get enough of. We started them out low. They kept climbing and climbing. They found their way into five-color sideboards. They found their way into Jund sideboards. And if I'm being honest, this was probably the worst weekend to be buying Great Sable Stag, but if you were playing at Nats, playing in the Grinders, maybe you're going for the PTQ, you had to have them. Everyone had to have them, so you had a huge price spike. After the season's over, you're going to see a huge drop-off, maybe up to 50%. Hollow Burial pretty much became Wrath of God. It went from a crap rare, you'd find it in the bulk boxes at any dealer 3 weeks ago. You could pick up a playset for $1 on eBay. I think they ended up about $7 or maybe $8 at some dealers. They've pretty much become Wrath of God. And for the next 3 months, while they're in Standard, that's your Wrath, people. It's not Austere Command, it's not Planar Cleansing. The one mana makes all the difference. If you've been reading Quiet Speculation, you know how hot we are on Magma Phoenix. It's an extraordinarily powerful effect. It's a board sweeper. It's a nightmare for control decks. The card just has a lot of potential. You can get them dirt cheap anywhere you look. Keep your fetch lands. Do not get rid of them. You will regret it. People think that just because they're rotating out of Extended that they're going to drop like a rock in value. And I don't think these people are considering the implications for Legacy and for Vintage, the Eternal formats. If you remember what happened with the Dual Lands, they left Extended for the first time and there was a huge outcry and everyone was saying, sell your duels, it's the end of days, you're going to waste your money, you're pissing money away. Underground Sea right now, the revised one will cost you $60. The whole name of the game with Magic Finance is being a step ahead of the crowd. You were a step ahead of this crowd, and you came into this weekend with a binder full of Hollowed Burials, you made $1 million. Everyone needed them. You left this weekend in a Rolls Royce. Stay ahead of the trends. You're not going to be left scrambling to scrape up the last copy of your staple card at the dealers.
Yesterday I didn't have to have that draft. I lost my last game to Infi 2 drops and Demonic Dread that doesn't let my guys block and he flips over like Putrid Leech or something. Anyway, this draft for this morning I was very excited about. I just went Naya, first pick Nacatl, got some really good stuff, and unfortunately it's not worked out. I could not beat a 2-2 Pro Green Bear, which is unfortunate, and couldn't beat a 2-2 Pro Green Bear. And then in game two, he had Sphinx Summoner and Double Fairy Mechanist and Putrid Leech. And I had Naya Hushblade, but of course he goes turn two Necrogenesis, which was kind of a beating. So.
Thank you.
is yours in your gifted hand. Confetti rain fall and the quiet stream. These things I've found are special now.
I always like the fatties.
Because tonight the world turned to me. Because right now I don't dare.
It's a game where you're trying to be a doctor. And
you're operation.
Operation.
Damn.
Come on, Lynn. Fruit fly people like.
What?
Count it!
That's it!
Oh, please! Please give me some Asian! Please give me some Asian!